Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Seeing Red, Indigenous Land, American Expansion, and the Political Economy of Plunder in North America, by Michael John Witgen. Narrated by Kaipo Schwab. Note on terminology. How we talk about and think about Native people in North America within academia and in popular culture has changed a great deal during my lifetime. For much of the 20th century in the United States, it was common to refer to Native people as American Indians, which for many good reasons is no longer the case. For the most part, as a scholar, when referring to the indigenous peoples of North America, I use the terms Native and Indigenous. Whenever possible, however, I try to use the specific names and signifiers of identity that Indigenous people use for themselves. For example, I use the term Anishinaabeg for the Great Lakes people, also known as the Odoweg, Ojibweg, and Borewaremi, even though these same people most often are presented in historical sources as Ottawas, Chippewas, and Potawatomi, and are written about generically as Algonquins. These anglicized versions of Anishinaabe names are given only when quoting sources directly. At times, I do use the term Indian and American Indian, most often when quoting sources directly, but also occasionally as a descriptor in historical context. The term Indian worked as a racialized category of social identity during the early Republic, signifying a savage or uncivilized person who was considered to be socially and politically excluded from the civil society of the Republic or any other civilized polity. I also use the term half-breed most often when quoting a source. For both Native and non-Native people in 19th century North America, the term half-breed indicated an indigenous person of mixed racial descent. Similarly, sources use the terms mulatto and quadroon, to mean African-American or black persons of mixed racial descent. These racialized terms are almost always used in quotations and always in historical context. Prologue. The Indian Liberating Army, Reimagining Native Identity in Colonial North America. Late at night, on August 23, 1836, the steamboat General Gratiot forced a black schooner sailing without colors to allow the St. Clair Sheriff to board the ship as it entered the St. Clair River en route to Lake Huron. The crew aboard the schooner, 23 men, were heavily armed and wearing what appeared to be some combination of British and American military uniforms. The sheriff charged the men with piracy, accusing them of stealing and butchering 3 head of cattle from a local farmer. The uniformed men sailed without official identification papers, and they refused to provide the sheriff with their names. The sheriff detained the crew and vessel for 2 days until an American military officer acquainted with the man in command of the schooner brokered a deal, enabling the detainees to pay a fine in return for their release. The Vermont Phoenix, reporting the event, concluded, "Whatever may have been the occupation or design of these men, it is certain that their appearance and that of their vessel was such as to create mistrust in the minds of those who met them." This might well have been the case, for these men had set out to filibuster California from the newly independent nation state of Mexico with the intent of founding an American Indian empire. Their mission, if not their appearance, certainly ought to have aroused the suspicion and mistrust of Americans living in the Northwest Territory during the era of Indian removal. The man in charge of the crew aboard the schooner called himself General James Dixon, although he also represented himself as Montezuma II, general and leader of the Indian Liberating Army. For approximately a year before his arrest in 1836, he made appearances in Montreal, New York, and Washington, D.C., talking up his expedition to the West and recruiting soldiers for his filibustering army. According to George Simpson, governor of the Northern Department of the Hudson's Bay Company, Dixon made quite an impression everywhere he went. Simpson described Dixon as an Englishman by birth of bold and desperate character, and noted that he cut quite a figure, being dressed in handsome uniform and sporting a large mustache and a face seamed with saber wounds. Dixon declared California to be the ultimate objective of his Indian Liberating Army. He claimed to have traveled extensively in Mexico and seemed familiar with the Anglo-American leadership fighting for an independent Texas. Dixon planned to add to Mexico's distraction by leading his army against Santa Fe. With Mexican forces on the defensive and concentrated east of the Rocky Mountains, the Indian Liberating Army would proceed to California, where they purpose remaining till joined by the Cherokees, etc. This at least is what Dixon told the Hudson's Bay Company trader William Norse at Sault Ste. Marie, who reported further that with their aid, they mean to endeavor obtaining possession of that country for the Indian tribes and locate them there under a military government. This newly formed indigenous government would prevent all except those of Indian blood from possessing an acre of land. The general spoke of his plans freely with American and Canadian officials as he made his way west. He talked at length with the missionary Edmund Eli at the American Fur Company post at Fond du Lac on the western shore of Lake Superior. "He keeps nothing back," Eli wrote in his journal. His plan is to form a government in California of the scattered Indian tribes of the West, Cherokee, Creeks, and all others who may be disposed to join them. What impression did Dixon, the Indian Liberating Army, and their quixotic quest make on Catherine Eli, Edmund's mixed-race native wife? Could she have imagined an Indian empire as a plausible future for herself and her mixed-race native children? Dixon's journey west began in Buffalo, New York, with an army of approximately 60 men. By the time he reached Detroit, he was down to 23, and when he reached Sault Ste. Marie, he had only a dozen. The diminishing Indian Liberating Army spent a month sailing across Lake Erie and up to the Sioux, swamping the boat on two occasions, crashing into reefs, getting arrested and detained for 2 days, and losing many more days tacking outside Detroit in search of favorable winds. Their bumbling progress and the need to fortify their provisions with stolen cattle so early in their expedition foreshadowed the fate of their adventure. That their route west brought the Indian Liberating Army north into the country of Anishinaabeg rather than into Mexican territory in the southwest also signaled the quixotic nature of the expedition. Yet, even with such a beleaguered start, Martin McLeod, commissioned as a major by General Dixon, wrote in his diary, "If I may judge from so short an acquaintance, he is somewhat visionary in his views." Dixon's route into the West reveals a great deal about the kind of people who found the general to be a visionary leader. Rather than heading immediately southwest toward Santa Fe, the remaining members of the Indian Liberating Army planned to travel along the southern shore of Lake Superior, exiting at Fond du Lac and journeying overland up the Mississippi River Valley, and continuing north to the Red River Colony established by the Hudson's Bay Company in Rupert's Land in present-day Manitoba. At Red River, according to Norse, they hoped to obtain from 100 to 200 recruits, mounted and armed. This curious route makes sense given the Indian Liberating Army's officer corps. In addition to Martin McLeod, his cousin, Alexander McLeod, John McLaughlin, and Charles McBean served as junior officers. Hudson's Bay Company Governor John H. Pelly informed the Colonial Office about the expedition and described the officers as well-educated young men. He also noted that McLaughlin, the McLeods, and McBean were half-breed, or the sons by native or Indian women of gentlemen now or lately connected with the fur trade. Simpson described these half-breed sons less charitably as wild, thoughtless young men. It would be easy to imagine mere adventure as a motive for joining the Indian Liberating Army, particularly for the non-native rank and file, mostly Americans, all of whom deserted by the time the party reached Sault Ste. Marie. Americans, McLeod wrote in his diary, damned impertinent and useless fellows. For the half-breed sons of Hudson's Bay Company traders, however, Dixon's expedition clearly represented an attempt to control their future in a world where race increasingly limited their possibilities. None of the officers who joined Dixon's army had been offered a position in the fur trade. In fact, at this moment, the Hudson's Bay Company was at best ambivalent about employing the mixed-race children of their white traders. For years, the company had relied on mixed-race voyageurs to conduct the mundane, labor-intensive aspects of their business, collecting and hauling pelts and trade goods. A few mixed-race men who had been taught to read and write by their fathers or in missionary schools in the West worked as clerks. But the company did not trust so-called half-breeds with posts of their own. The officers of the Indian Liberating Army did not fit neatly into the world created by the fur trade. They had been educated at universities in the East, where Dixon recruited them. But their Eastern education, combined with the facts of their parentage, left these young men in an awkward place, both within the culture of the Hudson's Bay Company and within the society of British Canada. Judging by their decision to join Dixon's army, their social and political status in the Canadian settlements must have seemed as uncertain as their place in the trade. In his journal, Martin McLeod expressed disdain for the capital of Upper Canada. "Remained one day at Toronto," he wrote. "Do not like the place." He described the people as somewhat pompous, and then wrote, "What have they to boast of? Their town or city is a muddy hole." McLeod also complained that they are up to their ears in politics. Damn politics. Imagining the future of Native peoples in Canada West. In 1836, Toronto was in the midst of considerable political turmoil, in large part because of the rapid expansion of Upper Canada, a reform movement pushing for parliamentary democracy and even colonial independence, had resulted in the appointment in 1835 of Sir Francis Bond Head as Lieutenant Governor of Upper Canada. McLeod noted the recent arrival of Head in his journal and linked his presence to the damn politics troubling the capital of Canada West. In August 1836, Head, in a letter to the colonial secretary, Charles Grant, Lord Glenelg, proposed consolidating the native population of Upper Canada by removing them to Manitoulin Island in Lake Huron. "We could persuade those Indians who are now impeding the progress of civilization in Upper Canada to resort to a place possessing the double advantage of being admirably adapted to them, and yet in no way adapted to the white population." Although the officials of British Canada failed to implement Head's removal policy, as part of the reform process, Britain's colonial office raised the idea of getting rid of the Indian department in both an effort to save money and in attempt to change the nature of the relationship between British Canada and its native allies. Specifically, Glenelg recommended that the governors of British Canada stop giving gifts annually to its native allies. In effect, he proposed that native peoples be treated as colonial subjects rather than as political and military allies. In November 1836, Head pushed back. "This expense will shortly be defrayed altogether by the sale of lands they have this year liberally surrendered to me. In addition, enjoying as we do possession of this noble province, it is our bounden duty to consider as heirlooms the wreck of that simple-minded, ill-fated race. The fate of native Canada is daily and yearly fading before the progress of civilization. Moreover, the regular delivery of the presents," Head argued, "proves and corroborates the testimony of the wampums." Head was referencing the ceremonial belts, made from quahog shells that colonial officials had exchanged with native peoples as a signifier of alliance from the establishment of Canada through the War of 1812. The annual giving of gifts reaffirmed this political relationship, and Head signaled the continued importance of this diplomatic practice. As a concession, however, he agreed to stop giving gifts to the Anishinaabeg who lived on the U.S. side of the border. In another letter to the secretary in April of the following year, Head emphasized that the native nations aligned with Canada continued to identify themselves as the children of the governor, their father. Changing this status would prevent British Canada from parentally governing these people according to their simple habits. The alliance, imagined as a form of kinship, in essence, allowed Head to secure both the political allegiance of and peaceful land concessions from the native peoples of Canada West. The Western expansion of colonial powers in North America. In many respects, the expansion of British Canada resembled the Western expansion of the U.S. Republic, but there were crucial political and cultural differences. Organized originally as the French colony, New France, Canada became part of the British Empire when the French lost the Seven Years' War. Following this transfer of power, the inhabitants or settlers of what would become British Canada understood themselves to be the colonial subjects of the King of Great Britain. The United States, in contrast, defined itself as a republic that had cut its ties with Great Britain, the colonial power that had established 13 colonies along the eastern seaboard, now organized as a union of 13 independent states. Both the United States and British Canada recognized their shared origin as colonial settlements, created and organized politically according to the natural law ideology used by European empires to claim possession of territory in North America. Both imagined that the continent had been an unsettled wilderness, inhabited by indigenous peoples who had failed to create, from their perspective, a legitimate form of government or recognizable property regime. By creating colonies in North America, the French and British empires believed that they had established dominion or sovereignty over an unsettled territory that they claimed by right of discovery. Within this New World political imaginary, Great Britain maintained an ongoing relationship with its colonial subjects in Canada, which included settlers, both immigrants and those born in Canada, and indigenous peoples organized as subordinate but allied native nations. The United States, in contrast, had been established with a settler colonial ideology that envisioned citizens of the Republic eliminating the indigenous population, replacing or supplanting the natives with its own settlers. Accordingly, even though it existed in the same New World political imaginary as British Canada, the Republic refused to see itself as a colonial power, and instead saw itself as a post-colonial state, a political entity that refashioned the meaning of native through the elimination of the indigenous. Whereas British Canada could imagine a future for native peoples, or Indians, as colonial subjects, the United States could only conceive of its republic without natives, Indians. In the first decades after the Revolution, a few political figures, most prominently Thomas Jefferson, advocated amalgamation, or the assimilation of native peoples into American society as they became civilized. This process would, of course, require native peoples to assimilate as individuals, meaning that over time, Indian nations would dissolve, vanishing from history. By 1836, however, this dream of a gradual amalgamation had given way to the idea of Indian removal, a call for the immediate elimination of native peoples. Native nations would be forcibly removed onto territory west of the Mississippi River, outside the boundaries of the Republic. Removal policy was predicated on two interconnected ideas. Some policymakers and religious missionaries believed that native peoples needed to be isolated from white society until they became civilized. Others believed that indigenous people were simply not capable of becoming civilized and needed to be removed beyond the boundaries of the Republic for their own protection. In truth, both approaches reflected a self-serving political justification for dispossessing native peoples of their lands east of the Mississippi. The leading advocate of removal in the United States was Lewis Cass, governor of the Michigan Territory from 1812 until 1831, and the Secretary of War under Andrew Jackson, who implemented the forced removal of people such as the Creeks and Cherokees west of the Mississippi to the Indian Territory. These were the native peoples that James Dixon hoped to coax into joining him in California to form a new indigenous empire. Cass believed native people were incapable of accepting the rigors of a civilized life, and accordingly insisted that they needed to yield their territory to settlers who were willing to bring progress and civilization to the North American wilderness. Articulating this vision of the future in the North American Review, a nationwide publication, Cass argued that a removal from their present position and from the vicinity of our settlements to the regions beyond the Mississippi can alone preserve from final extinction the remnant of our Aboriginal population. Dixon and his followers believed that Native peoples might escape extinction by removing to the West and creating their own empire. Extinction or Liberation? Alternate visions of the indigenous future. Governor Head also hinted at the extinction or vanishing of Native peoples, and the expansion of Canadian settlers into the West certainly resembled American settler colonialism. It would be more accurate, however, to think of cities like Toronto as settler enclaves that existed within a larger British colonial regime. As noted previously, unlike American settler colonialism, the colonial relationship between Great Britain and its Canadian provinces did not imagine the elimination of the native. Head might have wanted to isolate independent native nations within Upper Canada. Like his American counterparts, he seemed to think native peoples were fading away or diminishing in numbers. But he and the colonial office were not calling for their displacement, destruction, or cultural and political assimilation. The colonial office wanted to change the nature of the political relationship between the empire and its native nations in British Canada, treating native peoples as colonial subjects rather than as allies. The colonial governors of British Canada, however, recognized the value of having native nations as military allies along their exposed border with the United States. Governors of British Canada, like Head, wanted to preserve their alliance with native peoples in the Great Lakes, where the U.S.-Canadian boundary was ill-defined, because the United States possessed a rapacious appetite for indigenous land. The expansion of the Republic was predicated on the idea of transforming native homelands, imagined as unsettled wilderness, into American homesteads that could be incorporated into new states that would be added to the Union of the original 13. In the Old Southwest, in places like Alabama and Georgia, where cotton was king, and the soil of the Black Belt represented an ideal growing environment, the settler colonial ambitions of the U.S. Republic met with great success. In the cold climate of the Old Northwest, particularly north of the Ohio River and the Michigan Territory, the Republic found it far more difficult to eliminate the native population, which was needed to hunt and process animal peltry. In the Southwest, commercial farming formed the basis of the regional economy, and with the widespread adaptation of slavery, Indian labor was not required to facilitate the expansion of the Republic. Only their land was needed. In the Michigan Territory, the northern tier of the Old Northwest, the fur trade dominated economic life, and the fur trade required Indians to continue living and working as Indians. Economic conditions in the Michigan Territory provided little incentive for native peoples to assimilate to an American frontier existence of commercial or subsistence farming. Similarly, the region and its economy failed to entice non-native settlers in large numbers for exactly the same reason. When the remaining members of the Indian Liberating Army finally arrived at Sault Ste. Marie in the early fall of 1836, Martin McLeod described a small and rather dilapidated settlement consisting of 20 houses and a small military garrison on the U.S. side of the river. In his journal, he wrote, "There is here a cantonment of two companies of very awkward American soldados, commanded by a Major Cobb, a singular veteran who prefers anything to a clean shirt and any duty but a military one. His 18-feet picket fort is his world, and I verily believe his ideas never extend beyond the old sawmill above the fort." McLeod also noted the presence of a correspondingly large number of Anishinaabeg. "There are here at present quite a number of Chippewas, with their wigwams, on their return from the island of Mackinac, where they have been to receive their annuities for lands sold in this vicinity and along Lake Superior." He described the territory west of the Sioux as an immense tract, but of little value for agricultural purposes, and he noted that although the region had significant copper deposits, there appears to be some doubt whether even that can ever be made available. In other words, in the Northwest Territory, at least on the U.S. side of the border, native peoples were not, as Governor Head claimed, daily and yearly fading before the progress of an advancing settler state. They remained on their land living as indigenous people, even as they signed treaties forfeiting large swaths of their territory. In fact, it was the presence and political dominance of this large native population that caused officials of the Hudson's Bay Company and British Canada to express alarm at the idea of the Indian Liberating Army. They were not worried about the creation of an Indian empire in California. Rather, they worried about a native uprising in Rupert's Land, Canada's northwest. Simpson of the Northern Department reported to Pelly, the governor of the Hudson's Bay Company, the de facto colonial government in the vast northwestern interior of British Canada, "I learnt that their views were to proceed by Lakes Huron and Superior towards the Mississippi, thence up the River St. Peter's and through the Sioux country to the Red River settlement. Once there, they would excite dissatisfaction in the minds of the different Indian tribes and half-breeds under the plea of encroachments on their territory by the British and United States governments. The end goal, according to Simpson, was forming themselves into a great and independent nation." Simpson reported that his intimate knowledge of the Indian character caused him to worry that such representations from such sources might lead to much excitement among the different tribes through whom the party would pass. Simpson believed the threat posed by the Indian Liberating Army to be credible. Before writing his report to the Hudson's Bay Company governor, he received a letter from James McKay, a Montreal-based trader. McKay informed Simpson of the arrival of John George Mackenzie, the mixed-blood son of a fur trader with a long history in the Northwest who resented the monopoly of the Hudson's Bay Company. Mackenzie had been part of the expedition but was forced to return home because of illness. McKay reported, "They claim the whole of the company's territory on their inheritance by birthright." This claim suggests that at least some members of the expedition might have aspired to the liberation of native and mixed-race peoples in the Red River region from British colonial rule. They also claimed an unextinguished native title to this territory. This was precisely the danger that the Indian Liberating Army represented from the perspective of British Canadian officials. Native peoples, with national aspirations of their own, who possessed the design to create an independent indigenous homeland in the West that excluded white settlers. The members of the Indian Liberating Army imagined just such a future for indigenous people in North America. The fear that the Indian Liberating Army might actually pull off such a thing proved grossly exaggerated. Perhaps it was that the men Dixon recruited possessed a university education, as opposed to the skills of voyageurs, that made the dream impossible. Once they left Lake Superior, the men of the Indian Liberating Army needed native guides in order to find their way west and north, traveling overland, up the Mississippi River Valley, and onto northern plains in canoes and on foot. With the season so advanced, their guides deserted them after they departed the American Fur Company post at Red Lake. The Indian Liberating Army, reduced to 12 men, struggled as it advanced into the north. The men became lost. Their inadequate provisions reduced them to a ration of a single biscuit a day, until they found two Canadian voyageurs willing to escort them by cart to Red River. At this point, the Indian Liberating Army dissolved, and James Dixon vanished from the historical record. While the party made their way west, Simpson wrote letters to McLaughlin and the McLeods, offering them positions in the Hudson's Bay Company, and endeavoring to detach these young men who are respectably connected from such a disreputable enterprise. McLaughlin and Alexander McLeod accepted mid-level positions in the company and remained in Canada, loyal subjects of the British Empire. Martin McLeod rejected this path and returned to St. Peter's, establishing himself in the Pembina region as a fur trader and eventually marrying a Dakota woman. When Minnesota was organized as a territory, McLeod, assuming an identity as a free white citizen of the United States, became an elected member of the territorial legislature. For the mixed-race members of the Indian Liberating Army, the North American West, whether it be California or Rupert's Land, had seemed to offer the possibility of a native polity that was independent of either Canada or the United States. Given the dominance of the indigenous population and the absence of large numbers of white settlers, it was possible to imagine the Northwest as a place where native peoples could rewrite their narrative trajectory. Perhaps this was the allure of the Indian Liberating Army. James Dixon promised a future where native peoples survived and even reinvented their national identity as part of an indigenous empire in North America. The Indian Liberating Army represented a political imaginary where at least part of North America remained indigenous and independent of the continent's colonial powers. In this sense, the Indian Liberating Army offers a counterpoint to the teleology of the vanishing Indian envisioned by Canadian and U.S. officials like Francis Bond Head and Lewis Cass. It is also productive to think about the motivations of these mixed-race native men with ties to the fur trade and to the Northwest. Did they plan to filibuster California? Or was their goal the liberation of the Red River Colony from the Hudson's Bay Company? Did the Indian Liberating Army foreshadow the 1869 Red River Rebellion that led briefly to the creation of an indigenous province headed by the Métis political figure Louis Riel? Great Britain's colonial office wanted to transform native allies into British subjects, but whether they would be considered equals or racial subordinates remained an open question. The Hudson's Bay Company never really accepted mixed-race employees, children of their own agents, as equal in judgment, leadership, and authority to the company's white employees. And the Red River Rebellion and the refusal of Canada to accept an indigenous province into the nation at the birth of Confederation suggests that their national imaginary was not ready for this sort of racial inclusion. In this sense, post-colonial Canada was not so very different from the U.S. Republic. But examining the choices made by the native people who joined the Indian Liberating Army and thinking through their political ambitions suggest that at least some native people wanted a future independent of the colonial regime of British Canada. They did not seek a dual citizenship or dual identity as both members of indigenous nations and subjects of the colonial settler state. The United States saw itself as a post-colonial republic, but it was, in reality, an ambitiously expensive settler colonial state that offered an even bleaker future for Native peoples than the one Head envisioned for Native peoples in British Canada. The political imaginary of the U.S. Republic called for Western expansion at the expense of Native peoples on the ground in the territories being organized into new states. The Vermont Phoenix, which printed the story of the arrest and detention of the Indian Liberating Army, also featured two stories that revealed a vision of the Republic centered on Black segregation and Indigenous elimination. One of the articles, titled More Lynching, reported on the death by lynching of a Black man in Helena, Arkansas. Monday evening after the election closed, a man by the name of Bunch was taken and hung by the citizens of that place. Mr. Bunch was lynched because he claimed the right to vote, which was refused him by the judges, owing to his being a colored man. According to the newspaper, Bunch took umbrage at this rejection and resorted to violent measures. During the conflict, he stabbed a white man, and the paper reported this so incensed the citizens that Bunch was taken up and hung. The second article, titled Human Ferocity, told the story of a band of Creek Indians fleeing Georgia during the Second Creek War in an attempt to join the Seminoles in Florida and avoid forced removal to the Indian Territory. Georgia militia tracked down and killed all but two of the Creek men who escaped during the confrontation and fled in the direction of Florida. Two teenage Creek girls who had been captured in this fight, fearing for their lives, begged the militia captain to protect them. He promised to do so and left the captured Creek women with a militia soldier to guard them while he pursued the two warriors who had escaped. In his absence, the guard beat the two girls to death. Martin McLeod, in the diary that he kept throughout his service with the Indian Liberating Army, wrote that he had read a newspaper that printed the story of his arrest outside Detroit. Did he also read the articles about lynching in Arkansas and the ethnic cleansing of the Creek Nation in Georgia? Whether or not he read these specific stories, McLeod was reading newspapers that were chronicling the violent expansion of the U.S. Republic. By joining the Indian Liberating Army, he and his fellow Native soldiers signaled the desire to create a place in North America where Native peoples were not colonial subjects under threat of extinction. The Indian Liberating Army met with a failure that was both tragic and comical. And yet, this largely forgotten moment in North America's history underscores Native peoples' desperation to preserve their homelands and their independence, while the colonial powers that dominated the continent sought their subordination and destruction. Introduction. Indian Country and the Origins of the United States. On April 1, 1840, the state legislature of Michigan created Unwatten County out of 573 square miles in the middle of the Lower Peninsula. Unwatten was the name of an Odawa Ogima, a chief, who signed the 1836 Treaty of Washington. This treaty between the United States and the Anishinaabe Dodemag, bands of Odawa and Ojibwe people living in the upper and northern Lower Peninsula of what had been designated by the United States as the Michigan Territory, ceded approximately 13 million acres of land to the Republic. In return, the United States agreed to an annual payment or annuity of $30,000 for 20 years. This treaty also provided a one-time payout of $300,000 to traders who claimed the Anishinaabe owed them money for goods provided on credit that they had failed to pay back through trade in processed animal peltry. Finally, it allocated $150,000 to mixed-race Anishinaabe as compensation for their part of the land cession, offering them a cash payment instead of the creation of a land base reserved for them in their home territory. The 1836 Treaty of Washington was one of a large number of treaties that the United States negotiated with the indigenous nations of the Northwest Territory. the name that the United States assigned to the region that would become the states of Ohio, Indiana, Illinois, Michigan, Wisconsin, and Minnesota. The treaty process in the Northwest Territory provided the United States with a largely peaceful means of forcing Native nations to cede their homelands to the Republic, even though the Republic already claimed dominion or sovereignty over them. The logic behind this claim derived from a semantic distinction. Although the U.S. government recognized that Native people held title to their lands, it insisted that they had failed to take possession of these lands as property, and therefore had never established sovereignty over them. These treaties, which established U.S. dominion over the Northwest Territory, represented a massive transfer of wealth from Native peoples to the citizens of the United States. Native peoples ceded title to their lands to the federal government, which then converted this territory into the public domain of the United States. The federal government, acting as the sole proprietor over this land base, made it available for purchase as private property to settlers. These settlers were almost exclusively white, and they took possession of this land at a subsidized price in exchange for settling Native homelands and making them part of the U.S. Republic. In doing so, they entered into a social contract with the United States. They would not be colonists settling a foreign territory for the mother country. Rather, they were citizens creating homesteads and settlements in Indian country, which their government had deemed unsettled land over which it exercised dominion. Those settlements would be organized politically as territories administered by the federal government, and when the population grew to 60,000 white settlers, the territories could seek admission to the Union as states. The treaty process in the Northwest Territory not only represented a massive transfer of wealth from Native peoples to white American settlers, but also created a massive infusion of money in the form of specie into the regional economy. The federal government consistently spent more money meeting its treaty obligations than it allocated for the development of Western territories. These treaties resulted in annuities or cash payments, which, though designated for Native peoples, mostly wound up in the hands of traders, territorial officials, and local merchants. Many of the white settlers, traders, and officials who claimed this money were able to do so because they had married into the Native communities that were being forced to bargain with the United States. These white interlocutors, who most often had Native wives and mixed-race children, facilitated the negotiation of treaties by acting as interpreters, counselors, and debt collectors to the leadership of Indigenous nations. Representatives of the federal government made it clear to Native leaders that these treaties were their only chance for compensation. In this sense, treaty making between Native nations and the federal government was an involuntary or coercive process. Together, the treaty process, the land cessions, the annuity payments, and the supply of goods and provisions to Native negotiators created a political economy of plunder. The political economy of plunder. This political economy of plunder became the means by which the United States expanded into the Trans-Appalachian West, claimed by the Republic as federal territory, but occupied and controlled by Native peoples. In the Old Northwest, through the creation of the 1787 land law known as the Northwest Ordinance, the federal government established a legal mechanism that linked state formation to economic production and Indigenous dispossession. The law used the power of the federal government to extinguish Native title to land and then enabled the development of that land as private property. This transfer of wealth from Native peoples to U.S. citizens was not a mutually beneficial, market-based transaction. It was theft, a plundering of Native land and Native wealth, orchestrated by the federal government of the United States. The plunder economy not only stripped Native peoples of their homelands, their most valuable resource, but also deprived them of just compensation for this loss. Cash payments for their land were systematically claimed as debt by traders, merchants, and Indian agents who maximized their profit by also supplying the manufactured goods and provisions of food that the government agreed to provide to native peoples as part of their annuities. In the Northwest Territory, the political economy of plunder represented a mode of colonization that the United States masked as the physical expansion of the Republic onto unsettled Western territory. According to historian Peter S. Onuf, the Northwest Ordinance reflected a new way of thinking about territorial expansion. Specifically, he argues that a land system promoting economic development in the West would simultaneously promote the wealth and power of the entire nation. The U.S. Republic relied on the sale of indigenous land to generate revenue for the federal government, and it relied on the economic development of settler homesteads to boost the wealth of its citizens and increase the economic productivity of the national economy. The political economy of plunder created by the treaty process and implemented through the Northwest Ordinance was the engine behind the economic growth that made it possible to create and economically develop new states in the Northwest Territory. The United States acted as a colonial power, expanding onto new territory by systematically subjugating and exploiting native people and their resources. As the United States expanded at the expense of native peoples, indigenous people remained outsiders within the Republic, being created through their dispossession. That is, they were not citizens of the United States, even when they lived within the boundaries of states and territories organized as part of the Union. In the Old Southwest and in the southern tier of the Northwest Territory, where the agricultural value of indigenous homelands was high and there was easy access to U.S. markets via river systems, the U.S. government began to focus on Indian removal, a strategy that literally eliminated native peoples from the territory of the Republic and constituted an aggressive form of settler colonialism. In the middle and northern tier of the Northwest Territory, in contrast, native people who remained on their land to cede additional territory and draw annuities at annual gatherings could be a boon to regional economic development. Merchants and territorial officials in this region wanted to preserve a politically subordinate native population that received federal funds, which could then be siphoned off for their benefit. No matter the modality of colonialism, however, expansion of the national domain was integral to the economic growth and political development of the United States, and this growth and development came at the expense of native peoples, and, where economically practical, proceeded with the coerced labor of enslaved black people. The United States was not a post-colonial state settling an empty and unchartered wilderness. It was a nation of settlers created through the systematic plunder of native wealth and native land. In effect, the United States operated as both a settler colonial state and as a traditional exogenous colonial power. In this sense, the national history of the United States, like the colonial history of British and French North America that preceded it, chronicles the ongoing colonization of indigenous North America. Mixed-race natives and the idea of dual citizenship. The political and social status of mixed-race native peoples living in the Northwest Territory remained ambiguous and subject for negotiation as the Northwest Territory was organized into new states and incorporated into the Union. Mixed-race native peoples were often regarded by settlers from the East as non-white people, or, in the terminology of the 19th century, half-breeds. For the most part, however, the traders and territorial officials whose cooperation made the expansion of the Republic onto native homelands possible regarded this population as white. This recognition was part of the political bargain they made for facilitating the dispossession of their native kin. Their native wives and children would be treated as white citizens of the United States. Many mixed-race native peoples asserted native identities, but they also claimed identities as civilized people. in the early years of the Republic, being civilized was conflated with being white, and whiteness was conditional for exercising some of the privileges of citizenship, such as voting, holding public office, testifying in court, or serving on a jury. Conversely, Indianness was synonymous with being uncivilized and with living in a state of nature, which was interpreted as living on land that had not been converted into private property and was therefore deemed unsettled wilderness. Indians were thus excluded from the civil society of the U.S. Republic. The half-breeds of the Old Northwest, the mixed race Anishinaabe, rejected this simplistic racial formulation and insisted on an identity that was rooted in the social worlds of both indigenous and white people. In effect, they asserted what we would now recognize as dual citizenship. For example, many half-breed Odawa and Ojibwe people claimed a dual identity as Anishinaabe and as American citizens in petitions to the federal government and in the treaties that the federal government negotiated with their indigenous kin. Virtually all mixed-race Anishinaabe were the children of the male voyageurs and traders who worked the fur trade. Because the Anishinaabe were a patrilineal people, these mixed-race children, while clearly identified as kin, had no particular or clearly defined social role within the dodem and village communities of their mothers. U.S. officials frequently called upon mixed-race Anishinaabe who were working in the fur trade or as translators or Indian agents to take advantage of their position as both insiders and outsiders to negotiate the treaties that transform their homeland, Anishinaabewaki, into federal territories such as Michigan and Wisconsin. Unlike their mixed-race counterparts in the Old Southwest, among matrilineal people such as the Creeks and Cherokees, the mixed-race Anishinaabe, who aided the treaty process, did not sign these documents except as witnesses or interpreters. That is, they were not parties to the treaty. They received some form of monetary compensation for land cessions, but they were not included in the annuity payments and were not granted separate jurisdictional territories or reservations. In other words, these treaties marked their political exclusion from the nation-to-nation relationship between the federal government and their indigenous or tribal communities. This marginalization was the cost of asserting an identity that was both native and civilized, or both red and white, and was the result of an authenticity trap. From the perspective of 19th-century white Americans, any native person acknowledging some degree of whiteness admitted that they were not a real Indian, even if they were also not accepted as genuinely white. To claim this dual citizenship in order to secure a place within the Republic was to be forced to erase a certain degree of one's indigenous identity. Co-opting indigeneity. There was a constant, if inconsistent, dialectic between erasure and inclusion in the 19th century United States. The Republic seemed to struggle over how to think about Native people, valuing their legacy as the indigenous inhabitants of North America, while hating their presence as Indians, signifiers of savagery. This tension becomes visible in the naming and renaming of counties by the settler colonial state. As noted earlier, in 1840, the Michigan legislature organized a county named Unwatten, after one of the indigenous leaders who had ceded their country to the federal government. Several years later, the Michigan legislature reversed course and provided new anglicized names to counties that had originally been given Anishinaabe names. The county north of Unwatten, for example, originally named Rottawabet, was renamed Wexford. Reflecting the dialectic of erasure and inclusion, Unwatten County was also later renamed Osceola, the identity of the indigenous military leader behind the Second Seminole War. The Seminoles, refusing their forced removal from Florida, waged a war against the United States that humiliated the Republic, defeating the army and devastating American settlements. Osceola was captured under a white flag when he responded to a U.S. request for a parley. He died in captivity in 1838, and the war came to an end in 1842, when the United States agreed to allow the Seminoles to remain in Florida. In both naming a county Unwatten and then changing that name to Osceola, the Michigan State Legislature sought to co-opt the indigeneity of North American Native peoples. A county history of Osceola written in 1884 simply noted, "It was first laid off by an act of the legislature approved April 1, 1840, and received the Indian name of Unwatteen. It retained this name until March 1843, when it was changed by the legislature to Osceola." This historical account of the county offers no additional information about the naming process, no thoughts on why a county created through the dispossession of the local Native population would take the name of a leader of that community, and it offers no explanation about why that name would subsequently be changed to the name of a leader who had just led a successful resistance to U.S. expansion in Florida. It did, however, note, "Osceola County, Michigan, has no special Indian history. A few of these uncivilized people roamed about the forests for a while after the white settlers came in and then went out." This county history at least attempted to create the illusion of erasure by stating that the indigenous people went away following the arrival of white settlers. The idea of the vanishing Indian was a common trope in the United States in the 19th century. An early 20th century history of the names of counties in the state of Michigan, however, questioned the provenance of Unwatten, Osceola County. Why such a name taken from an Indian chief of Michigan should be changed to Osceola, the name of a Seminole chief from Florida, even though the latter had a national prominence and his unfortunate experience with the whites and unhappy death in 1838 were then fresh in the mind, is difficult to see. But what the author of this later history missed was that in the mid-19th century, approximately six decades after the founding of the Republic, the people of the United States understood that their country had been created on native land. Any adult resident of Michigan would have known that both Unwatten and Osceola were not literary characters. They were real people whose homelands had been taken from them. This realization must have raised questions about how the United States came to possess this indigenous land base. Was it stolen land, or was it acquired in a fair and legal manner? The United States had not waged a war against the Anishinaabe, so it could not rationalize their dispossession as a result of conquest following a just war. The United States had waged a war against the Seminoles, but although it managed to acquire possession of most of the state of Florida, the Republic had neither defeated nor removed the Seminoles from this territory. Americans, faced with a process of land acquisition that was morally ambiguous at best, often romanticized native peoples and popular culture, particularly those who resisted their dispossession heroically. Idealizing the heroism of dead warriors reflected a cultural and political appropriation that obscured the reality of indigenous dispossession. By incorporating native figures into the national mythology, the citizens of the United States gave themselves an indigenous past, including the noble dead, heroic warriors, and Indian princesses, into the story of America's creation, obfuscated the exclusion of living Indians from the social contract that the Republic extended to white citizen settlers. Romanticizing heroic native resistance also fits within the trope of the vanishing Indian. Osceola's bravery could be admired by the average American because he was conveniently dead. He represented that "live free or die" sentiment that emerged as a Revolutionary War motto, and his defiance could no longer cloud any admiration of his fight for the liberty and freedom of his people. He was, therefore, easy for the American public to co-opt. They could, in effect, claim him and his valor as their own, creating a true American hero. While in captivity, Osceola was painted by George Catlin, the famous painter of Indian peoples, who described his subject as the fallen prince and hero of Florida. And historian C.S. Monaco wrote about the valorization of Osceola in 19th century America. Romanticism helped sustain a legitimating illusion, a diversion that drew national attention away from the country's core aggression toward indigenous people by focusing on highly idealized and artistic creations. He also noted that the phenomenon of native peoples emerging as heroically iconic figures in popular culture had a parallel in treaty making, because it allowed the government to define the terms of the Republic's interactions with and manipulation of native peoples, while at the same time reinforcing Euro-American moral authority. The treaty process, though openly coercive, allowed the average U.S. citizen to imagine that native peoples had been treated fairly by their government. They surrendered their land because they wanted to and because they received fair compensation. Of course, the underlying truth to this false narrative may also explain the change of the county name from Unwanton to Osceola. Unwanton was likely still alive when the county was named for him, and he had not lost his country in either a just or an infamous war. He was swindled out of his land, and the sight of his people living on tiny reservations while white settlers occupy their homeland was an omnipresent reminder of that swindle. Better to name the county after the dead war leader, Osceola, who fought valiantly to remain on his land as it was seized by the American state. One could take pride in settling the homeland of a brave, but now dead and gone, indigenous warrior. Harder to take pride in stealing and settling the homeland of your living indigenous neighbor. This problem, however, is not confined to the early years of the U.S. Republic. The settler colonial project of the United States is not complete, but continues into the present. When is Indian land no longer Indian land? The stakes of ignoring the political and legal rights of one's living indigenous neighbors has reemerged as a contested issue in 21st century Michigan. In 2015, the non-native citizens of Michigan's northern Lower Peninsula confronted a powerful reminder of the epic land swindle that created their state. In August of that year, the Little Traverse Bay bands of Odawa Indians went to court to demand that the federal government recognize their jurisdiction over the territory of the original reservation granted to the bands in the 1836 Treaty of Washington. That treaty established 14 reservations for the Odawa and Ojibwe Dodemag, whose leaders signed the document, or touched the pen. The U.S. Senate arbitrarily altered the terms of this treaty during the treaty ratification process, introducing 5-year time limits to the reservations. The Senate's move to alter the treaty terms reflected the passage of the Indian Removal Act, signed into law by President Andrew Jackson in 1830. The Senate expected that implementation of the removal policy would result in the relocation of the indigenous population east of the Mississippi River. Removal, however, was not fully or immediately executed in the Michigan Territory. Some native peoples, like the Anishinaabe, managed to remain in their homelands. The Anishinaabe Dodema, living in northern Michigan, had agreed to the amended 1836 treaty because Michigan's Indian agent, Henry Rural Schoolcraft, assured them that they would be allowed to remain on their lands beyond the 5-year period. This understanding was codified in the Treaty of Detroit in 1855, which established permanent reservations in Michigan for the Anishinaabe. By 1855, the United States had become a transcontinental nation-state, and there was no longer an unsettled West to organize as Indian country that existed outside the boundaries of the Republic. The injunction filed on behalf of the Little Traverse Bay Bands of Odawa on August 2015 noted that the 1855 treaty created a 337-square-mile reservation that stretched 32 miles north to south along the northern tip of Michigan's Lower Peninsula on the eastern shore of Little Traverse Bay. The 1855 treaty included a scheme that theoretically allowed Native peoples to select individual land allotments and permitted any remaining land to be purchased and settled by non-natives. This scheme was not properly effectuated, and although the Little Traverse Bay bands of Odawa continued to live on their reservation, settlers acquired land not claimed as Indian allotments fraudulently. According to the injunction, the federal government's inability to administer the allotment process resulted in title to much of the reservation passing to non-Indians, but this did not operate to disestablish or diminish the reservation. Although much of the Little Traverse Bay reservation passed into the possession of non-natives, the tribe asked the federal government to recognize its legal jurisdiction and sovereignty over the territory established as a reservation in the 1836 and 1855 treaties, accepting this land as Indian country, regardless of who now owned it. In effect, the Little Traverse Bay bands of Odawa asked the U.S. federal government to acknowledge that its failure to administer land rights established through the treaty process resulted in their dispossession, but that it did not diminish their legal jurisdiction. They did not suggest that this history of swindle and dispossession be reversed and non-native citizens be dispossessed. They requested only that their jurisdiction over the original reservation territory be recognized. A brief filed in support of the tribe's lawsuit asserted that only Congress can diminish a reservation. Accordingly, the brief argues that regardless of the precise details of the swindle, timber trespass, and land frauds that plagued the reservation, it was not Congress who settled, stole, and sold parcels of land out from under the predecessor bands. The document concludes, a defense that relies on proof of these private thefts to invalidate the United States treaty promise defies justice and the U.S. Constitution. In an editorial published in the Petoskey News, Little Traverse Bay Tribal Chairwoman Regina Gasco Bentley explained the impetus behind the lawsuit. In the treaties, the tribe carried out its part of the bargain, she wrote. The lawsuit asks the court to uphold the treaty promises made to the tribe by recognizing the treaty reservation boundary. In an earlier article in the same newspaper, Jessica Intermill, the attorney representing the tribe, stated, "It's totally workable. It's just another layer of jurisdiction. Sometimes it's a complication, but sometimes it's a good thing because it provides more resources to the people." The tribe sought expanded jurisdiction over its people and community throughout the territory of the original reservation, not an extension of its authority over non-native people living on what they argued continues to be Indian country. In other words, they sought a restoration of the rights granted in a treaty ratified by the United States. Lance Boldry, a lawyer representing a regional homeowners association opposing the lawsuit, asserted that if the tribe wins a decree that 337 miles is Indian country, governance of this land will be forever changed. He then demanded that the tribe drop the lawsuit and negotiate the issues it claimed to care about with the state or face defeat in court over its claims that northern Michigan is an Indian reservation. Boldry's statement underscores a fact that for many American citizens is a painful truth. At one point, all of North America was essentially an Indian reservation. That is, when Europeans began to arrive and make settlements in North America, the entire continent was the homeland of indigenous peoples. The U.S. Republic was founded on land stolen from native peoples. This theft has been rationalized through the doctrine of discovery, the natural law ideology that imagined native peoples had failed to leave the state of nature, the condition of primitive humanity when mankind first left the Garden of Eden and all of the world existed as a commons. According to this ideology, civilization was created when humans began to transform this common land into private property, necessitating the creation of civil society and the rule of law through a process that consensually recognized a representative, sovereign authority designed to protect the property rights of individuals in that society. Following the logic of this ideology, Europeans rationalized that North America was in a state of nature when they began to arrive. Although it was occupied by native peoples, North America was, in effect, an unsettled wilderness. Imagining that Michigan was an unsettled wilderness until people of European descent arrived and began to establish proper settlements, homesteads delineated as private property and organized into towns and counties, makes it easier to rationalize the theft of Indian land. A treaty like that of 1836, however, in which indigenous leaders were removed from their communities as a condition of negotiation and were then pressured to mark an X on a document written in a language they could not speak or read that ceded 13 million acres of territory, was an act of thievery. The Treaty of 1855 that attempted to legally establish a dramatically reduced Odawa homeland as an Indian reservation, but actually facilitated further theft of this remaining land base, was evidence of the political economy of plunder that transferred indigenous wealth in the Great Lakes to the white citizens of an expanding U.S. republic. In August 2019, a federal court codified the work of the failed U.S. treaty process that produced this outcome, ruling, "The tribe's predecessor bands bargained for and received permanent homes in Michigan in the form of individual allotments. They did not bargain for an Indian reservation, and no such reservation was created by the unambiguous treaty terms, because the terms do not establish a federal set aside of land for Indian purposes, or indefinite federal superintendence over the land." The court concluded that examining the treaty in the relevant historical context, it cannot plausibly be read to have created an Indian reservation. To read the treaty as the tribe asked would be to recognize the superseding rights and authority of an indigenous nation to claim all of its homeland in North America. For the settler colonial state that is the U.S. Republic, such a construction of the past would simply be inconceivable. The people of the United States, past and present, citizens and newly arriving immigrants, could never imagine native North America before the Republic as anything other than an unsettled wilderness. To think of the continent as settled land, as a viable alternative to the United States, that is to suppose that the self-determination of indigenous peoples had resulted in permanent dominion over their North American homelands, would have been what the Haitian historian Michel Rouf-Triot has described as unthinkable history. For European colonists and American settlers, however, it was entirely conceivable that they had the right and the power to claim ownership of an entire continent controlled by the indigenous peoples of North America. Contemporary American citizens continue to find the idea that this continent already belonged to someone else to be an impossibility. This would be an unthinkable history. Seeing Red explores that unthinkable history. It examines the process and the ideology of dispossession that created a political economy of plunder, one that enabled the United States to forever change the governance of the region it identified as the Northwest Territory. The book is also the story of the Anishinaabe, mixed race or otherwise, and their attempt to shape their own history, to work the coercive system designed to rob them of all that they owned so that they could remain in their homeland and be recognized by the United States as a sovereign people. Chapter 1. A Nation of Settlers. On December 22, 1804, a delegation of native leaders from the lower Missouri River region arrived in Washington, D.C. Meriwether Lewis and William Clark traveling into the country of the Louisiana Purchase, sent these men east to meet with Thomas Jefferson, the President of the United States. A significant part of the mission of the Corps of Discovery Expedition would be diplomatic, not so much discovering an empty wilderness as introducing the Republic to the indigenous nations of Western North America. The United States purchased an enormous territory from the French Empire, approximately 828,000 square miles, stretching from the Mississippi River to the Missouri River, and encompassing land that would eventually become all or parts of the states of Arkansas, Missouri, Oklahoma, Kansas, Nebraska, North Dakota, South Dakota, Montana, Wyoming, and Colorado. The man behind this land grab knew full well that the country he had just acquired was occupied and owned by dozens of Native American nations. Jefferson instructed Lewis and Clark, as part of their mission, to send a few of their influential chiefs whenever distance was practical to visit the nation's capital and meet the President of the United States. On New Year's Day, 1804, President Jefferson received the chiefs of the Osages, Missouris, Kansas, Ottos, Pawnees, Iowas, and Sioux nations from the southern and central Great Plains at the White House. Jefferson hoped to impress these native leaders from the West with the modernity and the power of the United States. Americans imagined their relationship with native allies in terms of kinship, following the diplomatic protocol first developed by the French. The chief executive of the United States, like the colonial regimes of France and Great Britain, assumed the role of a father presiding over a family of native children. From the perspective of the colonial power, assuming the status of a parent and a patriarch made sense given the assumptions about its own political and cultural superiority. Some native nations resisted the implied subordination of assuming the role of a child and asserted their status as brothers, equal partners in the alliance. Many native nations, however, managed their relationship with colonial regimes by accepting their status as children, and then using that role to push the foreign power to act as a provider of trade goods and resources, or as a political intermediary. Regardless of the specific tactic, negotiating the relationship between native nations and colonial powers was a constant struggle over the degree of obligation and kinds of responsibility the parties owed to one another. When Jefferson met with the native leaders from the lower Missouri, he sought to activate the diplomatic protocol of past empires, establishing himself as their father. He also wanted to make certain they understood that their American father and the American people were different from the colonizers they had treated with in the past. "My friends and children," Jefferson began, "we are descended from the old nations, which live beyond the great water. But we and our forefathers have been so long here that we seem, like you, to have grown out of this land. We consider ourselves no longer as of the old nations beyond the great water, but as united in one family with our red brethren here. The French, the English, the Spaniards have now agreed with us to retire from all the country which you and we hold between Canada and Mexico, and never more to return to it. And remember the words I now speak to you, my children. They are never to return again. We are become as numerous as the leaves on the trees, and though we do not boast, we do not fear any nation. We are now your fathers, and you shall not lose by the change." Perhaps the visiting leaders took note of the language of accommodation, the idea expressed by Jefferson that Americans were united in one family with our red brethren. Or, more ominously, maybe they noted that Jefferson claimed a native or indigenous identity for the United States. "We seem like you to have grown out of this land." Jefferson's claim was not necessarily exclusionary. After telling the visiting leaders that Americans wanted to live in peace as brethren of the same family, however, he also warned these men, "My children, we are strong. We are numerous as the stars in the heavens, and we are all gunmen. The United States was a well-armed and fast-growing nation, an implicit threat. This new nation was descended from, but no longer part of, the old nations beyond the Great Water. The Republic Jefferson proclaimed was an American nation, a creation of the New World, just like the indigenous nations visiting the White House. The United States was not a foreign power. It was a nation of settlers claiming an American identity. The state of nature. Jefferson's vision for the Republic and the continent was linked to a particular understanding of the relationship between native peoples and the land. From his viewpoint, native peoples could claim a title to their homelands, but they did not own that land as private property. Jefferson assumed a natural law legal perspective, derived from social contract theory, that natives could claim aboriginal title or right of occupancy on their territory, but they did not exercise dominion over it. European powers, and later the United States, made this claim because they asserted that native peoples lived in a state of nature, that is, they were not part of the civilized world. North America was terra nullius, a legal concept dating back to the Roman Empire designating territory as vacant or unoccupied. Declaring North America terra nullius implied that the land had never been properly cultivated or truly settled. It remained, in effect, in a state of nature, the condition in which it existed at the beginning of time. As early as the 17th century, these ideas about natural law and the state of nature informed Anglo-American understandings of private property. At the beginning of time, all the world was a commons, whose resources were available to everyone. When human beings applied their labor to the things derived from this commons, the effort resulted in the creation of private property. A tree could be transformed into a table and chairs, making these items the possessions solely of their creator. A plot of land, similarly, could be transformed into a farm, with built structures, plowed fields and planted crops, and fenced enclosures, and entailed as private property. The cultivation of land thus carved out parcels of this shared landscape as private property, transforming the commons into a built or improved environment, a process accelerated by the creation and circulation of currency. In this increasingly complex setting, men and women were compelled to leave the state of nature and enter into civil society in order to protect their property. This was the social contract articulated most clearly by the English philosopher John Locke. Individuals gave up a portion of their rights, creating a government or sovereign designated to act on behalf of all members of society to ensure the rule of law and to protect the individual right to property and the pursuit thereof. In forming civil society, humanity left the state of nature and entered a world of laws and civil institutions designed to protect their rights and property. Appropriating the resources of the commons, men, particularly male heads of household, created civilization. With this rhetorical sleight of hand, European powers claimed possession of North America by right of discovery. Existing in a state of nature, the continent was an uncultivated wilderness and therefore an unsettled land. Using the same legal logic, European powers established dominion over their new possessions by converting land and resources into private property that, in turn, became part of colonial settlements, effectively establishing sovereign governments where supposedly none had previously existed. From the European perspective, immigrant communities in North America represented civilization and human progress.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.